It's the taint that will live with this man forever, because he will forever still be identified as a man that the public believed bombed the park.
Linwood, you told me last night that you thought he was guilty.
I did. I actually believed what I saw on television, what I read in the newspapers, and I thought that the FBI had their man, and their man was Richard Jewell.
I'm going to tell you something, Mr. Wallace. There's 6-7 people in this room with us right now.
Yeah.
And I don't care what they say now. That first week, everybody in this room thought I was the bomber.
That's true. Including me.
Yes, sir.
When I first met him a few weeks after the bombing, Jewell was still a suspect, and he is right. I did think he might indeed be the bomber. But I changed my mind after he described to me back then what had happened that night in July when he noticed a suspicious-looking package under a park bench and pointed it out to a federal ATF agent.
He was laying flat on his stomach, and he was undoing the top of the bag with his hand, and he was doing his flashlight like this, and all of a sudden he just froze. What really made me think this is, uh-oh, this is bad, is there was like a little line in training that they taught you that would instill in you, you know, and it was, if you see an ATF agent running, you better be in front of him.
So did you start to run too?
No, sir.
You stayed there within 10 yards of where the package was?
Yes, sir. We were just concerned with getting the people as far away as we could, as quickly as we could.
Can you stop for a second, please? Did you turn around?
Where were you?
What kind of questions were they asking?
That summer, Jewell was besieged by the media wherever he went. And the FBI kept following him, too. When he went out for a drive, they were always there. Not just that one agent in the blue Jeep, but a whole FBI convoy which chased him on and off the interstate. A total of 5 or 6 FBI vehicles. The FBI also searched the home of Jewell's mother, Bobby.
What'd they take out of your apartment?
They took Richard's guns, which he has always hunted. He deer hunts. Then they took all of my Tupperware. I mean, every piece of Tupperware. They took 22 of my Walt Disney tapes.
And the TV cameras were always there.
I felt like it was a movie production.
I felt like it was a movie production.
In Munich, where early this morning armed Palestinian guerrillas raided the sleeping quarters of the Israeli team. The gunmen shot dead 2 Israelis and are now holding 20 athletes and 6 officials as hostages. The guerrillas are demanding the release of 250 Arabs held prisoner in Israel and have set noon as the deadline for their release. Negotiations are going on with the German government. The raid happened at about 4 a.m. A liaison officer with the Israeli team takes up the story.
The police told us that between 4 and 5 o'clock this morning, a group of Arab Palestinian terrorists rushed inside the building, killed the coach of our wrestlers, Moshe Weinberg, and took as hostages some of our sportsmen. Afterwards, they gave an ultimatum that until 12 o'clock today, some of the Arabic terrorists who are held in prison in Israel must be released, otherwise are going to kill some of the sportsmen who are staying there in their hands.
The Arab Palestinians are in control of the Israeli block?
I don't know if the whole block, but at least at one of the entrances, which have some of the Israeli sportsmen there.
How was the Israeli killed?
I don't know, but as I can assume, he was killed in his bed.
Maintaining eye contact. This has to be one of the most obvious signs of a liar. Eye contact is linked with truthfulness. And multiple studies have linked lying with the inability to look someone in the eye. Although this has been explored by research, it only takes a little bit of common sense to see why this is true. Once again, it goes back to evasiveness.
After the shooting, the Palestinians allowed an ambulance to drive in to pick up one of the wounded Israelis, but the ambulance men retreated without him when firing suddenly started between the Palestinians and the police. The Israeli died soon afterwards. His colleague died in the flats. Nearly 500 German security police have now sealed off the village and are mounting heavy machine guns in the square. They are keeping cameramen and television reporters and spectators well away.
Paganism and the Olympic Games. The Olympic Games are a worldwide phenomenon. Every 4 years, these games are held in a different hosting city throughout the world. Most all countries send their best athletes to the Olympics to compete. The Olympics are touted to be an opportunity for peace amongst the nations and national bonding while creating an arena for friendly competition. They are seen as international goodwill, a confirmation of a country's sovereignty, acceptance in world's eye, and a way to build national pride.
It's, in many ways, it's a pretty basic, primitive human thing. This is a Neolithic ritual we're looking at here.
I think it was invented in 1936 for the Olympics.
Was an embarrassing fact that we like to conceal, but that's absolutely true. It was all the kind of mainly Riefenstahl. That's right. The symbolism and the Olympic guys have kept it going.
I felt like it was a movie production.
Speaker Ray Gunn captured the hearts of many during the Paris Olympics. Even though she didn't score a single point in the women's breaking competition, Gunn, who holds a PhD in cultural studies and lectures at Macquarie University in Sydney, entered the Olympic stage not just as an athlete, but as a testament to the diverse, unexpected paths that can lead to the Games. Dressed in a standard Australian Olympian uniform, Gunn immediately stood out among her competitors, who were clad in classic hip-hop attire, baggy pants, bandanas, and tracksuits that spoke to the roots of breaking culture. Her look, with her shirt neatly tucked in, mirrored her professional life as a college professor. A role she embraces when she isn't on the dance floor. "I didn't get the memo," Gunn joked in an interview with Yahoo Sports, acknowledging the contrast between her attire and that of the other breakers. Her humor and self-awareness endeared her to viewers who recognized her as an outlier in a competition dominated by much younger, full-time breakers. Gunn's journey to the Olympics is as unconventional as her performance style. She didn't start breaking until her 20s, introduced to the dance form by her then-boyfriend, now husband. Hailing from Australia, a country not typically known for its breaking scene, Gunn pursued her passion with determination, eventually becoming the top breaker in Oceania, which earned her a spot in the Paris Games. As the competition unfolded, Gunn faced formidable opponents, many of whom were world champions and teen prodigies. In the round-robin battles, she lost all three rounds with scores of 18-0. But her presence on the stage was anything but a defeat. Gunn embraced her unique style, one that she knew wouldn't necessarily resonate with the judges, but that she performed with pride. She skipped onto the stage, pumping her fist in the air, flexing her muscles, and performing moves that, while lacking the acrobatic flair of her competitors, were full of character and charm. At one point, she even playfully flopped around like a fish, fully aware that her approach was different, and delighting in it. "My style is not as suited to these events," Gunn admitted, referencing the fast footwork, power moves, and freezes that typically dominate breaking competitions. However, she showcased what she was best at. Basic downrock moves, a crabwalk, and a not-quite-vertical handstand, all executed with the grace and spirit of someone who genuinely loves what they do. For Gunn, the Olympic experience was about more than just competing. It was about representing herself, her country, and her journey, which has taken her from academic lecture halls to the biggest stage in sports. "I've never performed on a stage that big," she said, noting that Australia doesn't have events of that scale. The crowd, the music, the arena. It was all overwhelming and exhilarating for her. Despite not advancing in the competition, Gunn left the stage beaming, grateful for the opportunity to be part of something so grand. It was amazing. Such an amazing experience, she told reporters. Her story is a reminder that the Olympics are not just about winning, but also about the joy of participation, the celebration of diverse talents, and the incredible journeys that bring athletes to the world's most prestigious sporting event. Gunn's students, who had once doubted her Olympic aspirations, were left stunned when they saw her name on the roster. Her performance in Paris, though not a winning one in the traditional sense, was a victory in its own right, showcasing that passion, humor, and authenticity can shine just as brightly as medals on the Olympic stage.
Tom Cruise, this is real.
Yes!
It's a movie production.
America, let's go!
Do you believe what you have been seeing on CNN today, ladies and gentlemen? Can you believe it?